I work on the social media PR team at AMP Agency, which is a full-service marketing agency here in Boston. And I'm pretty excited to join you guys today. Thank you for coming out to talk to you a little bit about a study that we did examining the psychology of social media. If at any time, I know the sound is really quiet, if you can't hear me, please just raise your hand, wave it. I'll try to talk a little bit louder for you guys. All right. So it's no secret that social media has become the epicenter of the online consumer experience. And we are really well beyond the idea that social media is just a passing fad. We see that new social media networks are being formed on a regular basis. Even those that we thought were once fading away are now actually in kind of a resurgence, getting some renewed interest from consumers and any kind of user, even industry professionals. So understanding that social media is really here to stay, what we are looking to do is really truly understand what drives and motivates strong affinities for social media. Why are consumers and individual users really drawn to participating in social media networks? And I know a lot of people see social media as being very voyeuristic. Is it that voyeuristic aspect that really drives people to participate, or is it something bigger than that? So what we decided to do is put together this psychology of social media report and really examine how we can ultimately use the knowledge that we've collected here to create more meaningful experiences for individuals in social media space. Now I'm going to get a little bit academic here for you guys, just a second. So what we did to start off was to really look at Maslow's hierarchy of needs. Hopefully some of you out there have remembered, hopefully this sparked some kind of reminder of psychology class in college, or maybe even consumer behavior course. So what we did was we looked at Maslow's hierarchy of needs, which outlines the five basic human needs that are crucial to physical and psychological well-being. So if you start at the bottom of the pyramid here, we have physiological and biological needs, and this is everything from the need to breathe air, to eat food, to find shelter, and even to have sex. And then also building up through our needs. The need for security, the need for belonging and to build esteem. And then all of these really culminate in building a greater sense of ourselves. So we looked and we said, where does social media actually fit into these five hierarchy of needs? Well, we learned from some research that we did around the study that social media fulfills both mental and emotional needs for individual users, beginning with the need to feel belonging, and then moving upward through this pyramid to building esteem and establishing a greater sense of self. So in the end, when we think about what the purpose of social media is, really, it's all about us and our need to build a positive self-esteem. We do this through creating connections with other people and with brands or companies. We also do this by forming attachments with the social groups that we connect with in social media, as well as with the companies through our interests and our participation, and even engaging in activities with people, brands, or companies. We earn the respect from our peers, we develop our knowledge, and publicly identify ourselves as people who represent or are members of these social groups. And we do this with the purpose of discovering more about ourselves, really learning who we are, and establishing our own personal identity. And if we take a minute and we focus in on the connections that are formed with the people and the brands through social media, then we're one step closer to really understanding how that social media component really helps us fulfill the needs that Maslow put into his error. So before we begin to engage with others, we begin to form relationships and go through a decision-making process. Sometimes this is a conscious process, sometimes it takes a long time, other times it's kind of unconscious or subconscious process. We do it innately and in the blink of an eye without really thinking about it. You can see we have got some awesome cavemen here collecting in a group to build tools and to make some food. And what we do is we make these connections by first evaluating whether we need this person, this brand, or this company for our survival. If we determine that the relationship is essential to us, then we go to a second step in the evaluation process and determine how does this relationship really serve my needs. And we do this in a couple of ways. We look at the feel-good reasons. Are we following a blogger because they share their experiences that are very similar to our own? This is really what we see a lot with parenting, mommy and daddy bloggers. We need to share their experiences of parenting and share advice with each other. Or are you looking to become part of a larger social group that has a common or similar interest with us? We see this with forums and message boards, where people create these environments that cover very specific or niche topics. And it's a place where people can gather, ask questions, and actively communicate with each other. And we've even seen, in the case of celebrities like Lady Gaga, Britney Spears, and even some of our own industry rock stars, that we identify with these people and form relationships with them because we're interested in learning more about them. They serve as role models for us, or in even some cases, we idolize them. On the other hand of this, we examine these relationships for a utilitarian purpose. Are we going to align ourselves with brands, people, companies, because we want access to news and information? Are we learning something from them? We want to increase our knowledge base. Or is it simply to get access to an offer or a discount or a deal on products and services? And now that we really start looking at the connections that social media experiences, we determine that there are needs to make a connection and that the vehicle that helps us make those connections is social media. We see there's a couple of different stages here, identifying short-term needs, long-term needs, and how we determine that need state comes from the result of the evaluation process. We see it with the initial determination that there's a need to connect with somebody. The immediate need there is to establish that short-term connection. And this is where we see people kind of dipping their toe into social media. Maybe they're creating a Facebook page for the first time, they're setting up a Twitter account, they might add their friends and start seeing what their friends are doing. They might even start searching some blogs or some keywords to see what kind of conversations are happening. Maybe just doing a simple search for pictures on Flickr or videos on YouTube. This is what I like to call the stage where a lurker is born. These are people that are just kind of passively consuming information on social media channels. They haven't really decided who they are or what they're looking for in social media yet, but they want to see what's going on out there. As they become more comfortable in the space, the after effect really is beginning to become attached to social groups and communities. As they become more comfortable, their need really evolves, and then that's when they start to get a little bit more from the community and even participate more from the community. So we see this lurker that's just passively collecting information turn into a more active community user. They might start commenting on posts that they see, responding back to friends that post things on their wall, on Facebook. We might see them start sharing their own experiences via commenting on blogs or news articles. And we might even have them start being a little bit more vocal about their perspectives and their opinions about the things that they're seeing in social media. For some of the users out there, this long-term need continues to evolve. Some people stay at this certain level to become attached, and they kind of go on and talk and do a little bit here and there, but then never really participate beyond that. Others, that need really grows, and they start to create their own content. They start creating their own blogs, writing their own blog posts to share with others. They might start leading forums or user groups and message boards, and start being the conversation starters rather than just the conversation participants. This is where we see individuals become thought leaders in industries or and even their love of a certain brand or product. And they really start to influence others rather than just being having the influence exerted upon them. And then all of this, really, particularly with becoming more active in the social space, becoming a content generator rather than just a content consumer, it lends back to Maslow's hierarchy of needs, and that providing leadership and kind of owning this content really helps these users to build positive esteem and gain the respect and kind of the prestige that comes along with that from the community. So now that we know what people's needs are and how these needs can be fulfilled through social media, what can we do to create a more meaningful experience in social media? And I hope everybody see this. I mean, it's nice and big for a reason. If you write anything down, if you tweet anything from this presentation, I really hope that it's this statement right here, that targeted content really is the key to building immediate connections and long-term attachments with other users. To do this, we really need to identify who our audiences are, who we want our audiences to be, and to understand what drives them to make connections, whether it's with us or other individuals or even brands or companies, and how can we help them move through the process of evaluating us as a valuable connection and then converting that connection into a really meaningful relationship where they're actively engaged and participating with us. Once we've gotten them engaged in that process, then we can go back and evaluate how are we getting them to take an action that we want them to take. So if we talk about the different types of individuals, we look at three main ones here. There are several more that we can fit in just for time. I've kept it at three. But we've highlighted these three, the emotional decision makers, the rational decision makers, and the skeptics, who are going to be my makers. Our emotional decision makers are those who we read about in a lot of industry articles, or even see in infographics. These are the people that rely on the recommendations from their friends, their family, and their peers before they make any kind of decision, whether it's a purchase decision, to follow a brand on Facebook, or to participate in any kind of informational series, or participate in blogs and message boards. These are the people that really rely heavily on collecting user feedback. They want to know ratings, not only from their friends, but from strangers. They're very interested in reading through reviews. They might be like me, where they read through every single review on Amazon that they can find about a product before they actually make a purchase. Or they're heavily influenced by who their friends like on Facebook. So they might evaluate a brand, decide whether they want to be friends with them, and then are kind of pushed over the edge as soon as they realize that a few of their friends can follow that particular brand as well. Next are rational decision makers. They really focus on the benefits and the outcomes of making these decisions. They seek out information and they base their decisions mostly on evaluations, comparisons, rankings, whether it's a different products, or they're just comparing things in their head, the benefits of following one brand or company versus another, or participating in one conversation versus participating in another conversation. And while they do collect feedback, most times it takes a backseat to this analysis that they're doing. They're very analytical, they're very data-driven, and sometimes it can just come down to a discount or a coupon or a deal that actually sways them to participate or like another brand or like a brand on Facebook or a product on Facebook or even actually use that product. And then finally, we have our skeptics. Our skeptics rely mainly on the reputation of brands or individuals that they want to form connections with, and these heavily influence the decisions that they're making. And these decisions range from purchasing an item, or even deciding to align themselves with a company or an individual. They collect a lot of user feedback. They rely heavily on unbiased reviews. They might read the good and the bad just to get a full sense of this particular brand's reputation. They might base it on what they've seen in the media. And really use these reviews and these rankings to help inform their decision making. building meaningful social media experiences. Really, we do this by determining what the best content is to help us make this connection, and then following through by defining what our objectives are, what our call to action is. The most basic of these objectives are effect and defect. If we are looking to influence others to change their perspective or their behaviors or even their opinion, or are we looking to do something more like get some concrete results from them? We want them to make a change. We want to drive them to make a purchase. And these both need to come into effect when determining what your outcome is. Sometimes it could be a little bit of both, or maybe it's starting at one and then moving to the other. From the position of a marketer, maybe even a digital influencer, if we're looking to affect somebody, again, it's how are we going to change this person's perception by the content that we are creating? Are we going to exert our influence over them? And is that changing a negative perception about a brand or a company, or maybe even a person, somebody who is in media a lot, is involved in scandals? What are we doing to kind of influence the change there in how they think about the person that we're talking about? On the other side is the effect. That's when we're really looking to drive a specific action from an individual. Do we want them to purchase a brand new product? Do we want them to purchase a product that exists in the market previously that they might not have been aware of ever before? Do we want them to visit our website? Do we want them to like us on Facebook? Or even do we want them to do something simple, like sign a petition to make a change? These are all concrete results that we can measure and would be considered effects when we're determining our objectives and our outcomes. So when we kind of put all of this together and start thinking about what our content strategy is and how all of this background information about who individuals are, why they're going to be connecting with us, what kind of content they're looking for, then we can really start to shape what our content strategy looks like, whether it's via social media, whether it's on our blog, whether it's our website, paid media campaign, really runs across the board. We'll find that once you have determined what the content is, what the objectives are for each piece of content, then everything will kind of fall into place. You can start to think about what do these items creatively look like, what are the types of things that we should be talking about or producing. And that's going to be moved into really what the future of social media is. Really right now, social media is about satisfying these connection needs states. As we look to the future, we need to be mindful of how we can best make these connections and how these connection needs are changing. They might not always be the same, particularly if we're following a consumer as they age or as they move through different life stages. There are three really big areas that we can focus on here. The first is really harnessing the social web. Hopefully social web is not a relatively new term for anybody in the room. If it is, I'd be happy to take questions later. Also, understanding the constant communication. We are constantly communicating with people via our laptops, via our cell phones, even talking to each other. There are tons of different ways that we're influenced by being constantly connected with those around us. And then really, how are we creating a harmonious social experience for individuals, whether they're consumers, users, participants in our message groups or on our forums? Then we kind of break this down into actual actions that we can take. The first in harnessing the social web is really doing some dynamic audience mapping. Next, when we're talking about constant communication, taking a look at social media convergence, and then really looking into social media integration and how that can help us create this harmonious social experience. So now we'll get into kind of the more details of each of these and talk about what we can actually be doing and how these can be helping to steer our content strategy. The first is really harnessing the social web. Social web, I know there's been a lot of conversation about social graphs and interest graphs. Really, the combination of those two is the social web, what we're experiencing now. And this is a web experience or an internet experience where you're always just one click away from a social media interaction, from sharing with somebody, from participating in a conversation with someone. And it doesn't matter if you're on a brand website, if you're on a media website, or you're actually physically on a social media network. Part of using the social web here is helping us to develop this dynamic audience map. So we really want to understand where and how is our audience engaging in conversation. Are they using one channel more than another? How are the conversations really happening in that particular space? And what's the tone and the sentiment of those conversations? Do we see different demographics speaking on different channels or participating in conversations on different channels? And how do those channels vary? And how can we create content that's custom fit to each of the demographics communicating on that particular channel? And that's part of this greater plan to create more tailored content so that we're actually putting content up on these channels that we know that is going to attract the consumer that we're looking to reach or the individual that we're looking to reach and really help them seek that information as well as consume that information on a variety of different. And then finally, this all kind of leads to building stronger relationships with our influencers in those spaces. If we're putting content out there that people are automatically already interested in learning, learning about or finding or sharing, then we can see who's the most active influencer in those space, and we can target them with specialized content, really get them involved, let them know that we're paying attention to what they're saying, what they're doing in space, and help them share that information and foster those connections with each other on behalf of us. Next, going into social media convergence. Hopefully, almost everybody in this room has a smartphone. You know how often you check your smartphone for updates, maybe checking your email, going on Facebook, tweeting something really quickly. These devices have become ingrained in our lifestyle, particularly if we're talking about millennials and younger. They have never experienced life without an iPhone. And really, part of having this device ingrained in our culture is that we develop these physical and emotional connections to our devices that really lead to this continued convergence of technology. We see that we can watch TV and interact by holding our phone up to the TV and letting it record via an app called Shazam. And then we are given more information via our phone. Sometimes we're sitting on the couch with our laptop in our lap. We're Google searching things as we see commercials, or we're learning about celebrity news or even upcoming things in the news. And all of these kind of connections and the ways that we can engage in different communication tactics and use our devices really helps these social connections infiltrate all aspects of how we consume media. So we're not just talking about watching TV. We're watching TV, surfing the web, and maybe reading something, or sitting on the train and working, but then also checking our email and IMing with a friend or a colleague. And really, the next step in this that we're already seeing a resurgence of with new mobile payment systems like Google Wallet and Level Up is that we're always one click away from something that we want. In the case of purchasing, we're always one click away from being able to purchase something that we see that our friend likes on Facebook. We're always one step away from popping into a coffee shop that we've never been to and actually purchasing a coffee because we happen to walk by and Foursquare gives us an alert that one of our friends posted a tip about it, and we wander in, and then we pay using Google Wallet, or we pay using Square, and then we're out of there. So every single thing that we do is, and how the technology plays into what we do on a daily basis, really gets us one step closer to just being only one click away from a connection or a purchase. And then finally, we take a closer look at social media integration, creating these seamless experiences across all of our channels. Are we using common themes and messaging on our website, as well as our social media channels, through our paid media, is it through our blog, and anything that we happen to be touching? It's really, really important. Are consumers going to be confused by the messaging that they're seeing from the different channels? really to prevent that confusion, the best thing to do is to take a step back and say, what is our common theme? What is our message? What is our objective? And how are we using those two pieces, our theme and our messaging, to help us achieve that objective? We can also help foster connections with others, and this alludes a little bit back to what I mentioned previously with conversions, and that by creating the content that helps fulfill these needs, then we're really able to foster the connections with others. It might be people that we're already connected to, it might be people that we're hoping to be connected to, or people that have heard about us, but haven't really connected with us yet, and are looking for a reason to make that connection. And then we can help facilitate those connections and the fulfillment of those needs by really building an identity and helping them build an identity by creating likable and shareable content. And this is content that not only speaks to their needs, but by using features that allow us to facilitate that sharing and that liking. So putting social sharing plugins on our blog posts so that people can always just click once and then share it with their communities. Is it using Open Graph and putting a like button on our website or on our product page so that people can immediately, in that moment, click like and then share with the rest of their community and really help build their identity by aligning with our brand or our product? Really by allowing them to connect in the moments, we're taking advantage of the fact that they really are seeking that connection. They might have already established a need for that connection. And now, by it happening right then and there, we're allowing them to move on to the next step of really becoming attached to our brands. That's about it, what I have for you today. I hope that you've gotten a little bit of insight into how you can use some of our old school stuff like Maslow's hierarchy of needs, some of the amazing things that we've learned from the social psychology of social media study to really help guide your content creation strategy. Hopefully you'll be able to identify really quickly that you already have an active network and you can determine who is in your network and whether they're starting for information elsewhere or if your content is really reaching them in the way that you're hoping to reach them. So with that, thank you so much for joining me this afternoon, letting me come and speak. Also, thank you for letting me fulfill one of my needs, Maslow's hierarchy of needs. I'd love it. If anybody has any questions, I'd like to take questions. Anything, if you guys can queue up at the microphone, it'd be easiest.
This is a part of comment and also a question.
Sure.
I think the biggest part of social media is listening.
And absolutely.
Kind of the slides don't sort of highlight that fact because that's part of knowing your customer. And sort of if you become a part of a social network and listen and learn, you get to see what the needs are. And the only reason people communicate is because we have a need. And the purpose of communication is first to understand, then be understood. So what I see a lot on social media is a lot of transactions, and to differentiate that, which is different than dialogue, so it's sort of like, shh, it's McDonald's, you know, please drive around type of stuff. So I think listening is critically important if you don't want to become a talking head and just dump and push data on people. If you want to create genuine engagement, you're going to have to be present, and it does take time, really, in the moment. So my question that leads up to this is, how do you avoid transacting with people on social media, and what are your tips for creating genuine engagement and really dialogue?
Sure. I absolutely agree with you. Social media is very much about listening to the conversations that are happening. And we're seeing now that brands are really struggling to move into this phase where they're listening, everybody talks about big data and what to do with this information. And really the simple answer is start participating. It's not just about listening to what's going on anymore. Start actually having those conversations and talking directly with your users and your consumers. And one of the best ways to get started in that process is understanding what your personality is. Is your personality, as an individual, does your personality shine through your social media presence? As a brand, have you even developed what your social media personality is? And once you have that personality in place, it's a lot easier to create a genuine conversation. When you're not shying away from being the talking head or pushing out content, just hoping that people will kind of consume it and then start their own conversation, then that's when people it kind of clicks for people and they can say, okay, this isn't just some blank, faceless person that's talking to me. This is an individual, whether it's an individual representing a brand or an individual representing themselves in the social space. And you'll find that as you start injecting some personality into the content that you're posting, people will naturally start communicating with you more because they're looking for a more human connection, just inherently. Yes.
That was a great response, by the way. No, but I think you can think of social media in terms of sales. Literally, the simplified sales process, to boil it all down to four nuggets, is know, like, trust, buy. So if you don't know who you're talking to, and you're not having dialogue, they're certainly not going to trust you, and they're not going to buy any of your service, products, or solutions, or even donate to you.
Exactly. And in some of my experience in managing communities for some of my clients, we found that really, if you take the time to connect with people on a personal level first, then they're more receptive to those sales messages. And it seems like something so simple, but really what people are looking for is that connection first. And once they feel like you're actually listening to them and you're understanding what they're saying, and you're participating in the conversation, kind of just, instead of just like spitting out canned responses to them, then when you do have product information to share, they're a little bit more receptive to it. And they're actually actively linking the links back to the website to look at the product pages. They're asking for samples, or they're actually going into the store and making a purchase, trying a product out for themselves, and then sharing it with their friends. So really focusing on making that personal connection first before you start pushing out any of your marketing content is key to creating that genuine environment in which people will be more receptive to what you're telling them.
Could you use the microphone, please? Sorry.
Have you defined the different social media outlets in terms of their demographic basis?
Sure. We have looked at several that we work with that really fit for our clients, but absolutely, there are different social media networks to be used to reach different audiences. Everybody is really quick to say, if you want to target millennials, you need to be on Facebook. We're seeing now that the boomer generation is actually joining Facebook at an alarmingly high rate. So that is now a new channel. It's constantly morphing, so it is really important to keep an eye on what's going on. We see now things like the change in Twitter, where previously we only saw that it was businesses communicating with each other or identifying with media outlets or seeking to connect with digital influencers. But now we're also seeing that there's a huge resurgence in young teenagers using Twitter as well. And they're also using it in completely different ways than we've seen previously. So teenagers might use Twitter more as an IM service rather than a place to collect information or communicate with other brands. And then there's a bevy of other social networks. But each has their own specific target. And really, by doing some simple searching online, you can find a lot of information about the demographics that frequent that particular channel. I would definitely recommend, before you explore actually creating a profile in any channel, is to take a look at something like a Quantcast report, even a Nielsen report, to find out how the demographic that you're looking to reach is indexing on that channel. And then just go on and take a look and see what kind of conversations are you seeing happening? What does it look like the people, the demographic that are using it more frequently or in a way that you'd like to communicate on? And then use that to help make your decisions about where you want to start your social networks. I've only got a few more minutes.
Sure, if you could go up to the microphone, please. Really quick, I'm just wondering if you're going to post your presentation on your website.
Yes, I will post it online. We'll make it available. It'll probably be up on SlideShare, and then you can also find it at ampagency.com. ampagency.com. Sure, one last question, really quickly.
Yes, I have an individual with multiple companies, and I don't have a lot of time, and everybody tells me I have three companies. So everyone says I should have three Facebooks, three Twitters, three LinkedIns, three Pinterests, and on and on and on. How do other people manage that kind of a situation?
Well, I think if we're talking about three completely individual companies with different product offerings, they might exist in different industries.
They're all related to websites.
Oh, okay.
And WordPress.
All right, then I think the first place to start would be to identify who your target is for each of those businesses, and then determine if the channel, what channel is best for reaching each of those targets. And then you find that you might not need to have three Facebook pages if one particular website or one business is geared towards the demographic that most heavily uses Facebook, then create a Facebook page for that particular profile. If you find that another audience uses Twitter more frequently, then you might just create a Twitter profile, and then you're not dealing with everything in sets of threes. And then even to help with that, using some free third-party tools to help you populate that content, kind of get ahead of the curve in terms of making sure that there's something going up on a regular basis, will do wonders for keeping you organized.
You talking about something like Buffer app?
Yeah, absolutely.
Thank you.
Thank you, guys. All right.